Such explanations would have us believe that poverty is a social cause of criminality. If poverty would make us vicious and murderous, riches should certainly make us happy and virtuous. In that case, there would be no independent goodness or viciousness in the human soul, and the only remaining human reality would be that of want and plenty. We then would be able to invest in what precise point in a lowering seasonal unemployment curve a population begins to think genocidal thoughts, or at what exact point of hunger or of cold a person begins to relish the idea of torturing and murdering his fellow human beings. In that case, the story of Job would have truly lost all relevance for our modern world. There would then be no longer any question of a human soul, of consciousness, of good and evil, of virtue and vice. It would be very difficult to look in any direction in such a world and not to see several paths leading straight into the direction of another Holocaust.
What was happening during Germany, what the borders were during that time.
Well, what's commonly done is to show the occupied countries, for instance, to show Germany before the war and Germany at the end of the war in terms of the numbers of countries of Europe that were occupied. It's also common to show concentration camps and death camps. It's also common to show numbers of Jews who were refugees, percentage of Jews who were refugees in those countries. I have seen a map that illustrates, for instance, at Auschwitz, how many of the murdered were specifically Jews or non-Jews, or how many soldiers who were Jews or non-Jews, and that sort of thing actually is imposed on a map. At this point in time, I haven't seen that.
But I don't think that's what you would have been asking. You've been asking.
What I'm asking is that Hitler's regime did damages to other Germans,
from the mind, dude.
That people, for instance, from East Prussia had to leave, and from Silesia and other areas.
After the war?
Yeah. So.
Right.
Hitler's regime did not affect only Jewish people. It also affected other Germans.
As a consequence, yes. And that would be a theme by itself, which would be worth discussing, yes. What was the aftermath and how it had hit the Germans after Hitler?
Well,
any other questions? Preventing it. And that is a very important thing. And that there are some parallels because some of you who remember that history, 1938, the Munich Agreement by Chamberlain, when he felt that he had an agreement by Hitler that no further territorial demands will be made in Europe by National Socialist Germany, or more specifically by Hitler only, and then he came to Lawn and maybe Chamberlain, Neville Chamberlain, and he came back to London and showed a piece of it in which it says, well, now we have a peace of our time. And the peace was very quickly broken because the demands which Hitler continued to make broke the Munich Agreement very quickly. So before World War II started, many people got hurt in the process. And we see that with modern technology, of course, more people get hurt in the process quickly. And before we start to intervene, and I'm talking about intervention, it takes a long time, many people get killed, and that's precisely a crucial question. How long do we wait until we stand up and say no more, and do something to prevent that bloodshed which is occurring in former Yugoslavia at this point? And I think we could have prevented that if we would have said earlier that there is no way for the people to continue by means available to us, and not necessarily an engagement which would be a warlike engagement, but by an intervention which may have applied and used force, so that the Serbs would no longer be in a position to expand into territories and do the slaughter which has been done up to this point and continues. So it is a time when we have to stand up and say no more, and we really need to band together and prevent it, because otherwise there is no end to it. Distances have become much closer. We all are interrelated much more than ever before. We are obligated to act because it will reflect not only on us, but it will have very direct consequences in all parts of the world, especially the Western world, of course.
I'd like to say one more thing about that. I see something, one very positive thing happening, and that is that, but I know, our getting on a plane going through this month, last month, next month, and this is what happens when your governments are inactive. Citizens have to act, and I'm not sure that they'll know what to do, but in any case, they're going to find more information, they're going to get involved, and this is what does happen, unfortunately, in the modern world, and sometimes people just decide to go and become involved, and it should happen in Somalia, it happens in Nicaragua, it happens in a number of countries where people could no longer stand what was going on until they got on a plane and began to try to help.
In other words, we need to exert pressure in order to get some action. And that can only be done when we are consolidated and in agreement with each other. Any other questions? Yes?
As my role says, along the same line, it seems so much like, you know, the United States and a lot of our citizens are so concerned and sympathizing with what's happening in other countries like Somalia, Bosnia, all over the world, but yet at the same time, to me it doesn't seem like we're paying enough attention to what's happening within the United States, within our own communities here, and that we're not taking enough stands for different causes that we could be taking stands for here as Americans with our own people, you know, and not to negate what's happening in other parts of the world. There are so many issues that just seem to be disregarded, and you know, I have no idea what's because of that, which if we're looking at the Holocaust in terms of whether or not it can happen again, will happen again, I could pay more attention to what's happening in our own backyard in regards to different issues, which is, you know, the death penalty, poverty. And I found it a little bit confusing to me what Professor Jager was saying in his essay with regard to class, because I seem to feel like I do think that class has a lot to do with it. And I don't know if he was negating that, or I guess you can't answer that.
Well, that is something which I think one needs to ask him in order to get a proper response from him. There are obviously different points of view, and he's proposing this point of view which we have heard. Now, but I think I totally agree with you that our concern is not just something which should be directed towards countries where there is indeed a genocide taking place right now. That indeed is absolutely essential. But obviously, if we are concerned people, we also be equally concerned with what happens here in the United States and will act accordingly, become activists along these lines and see to it that changes will be introduced which are absolutely necessary. Which includes racism, which includes conditions which are unconscionable and need to be changed in ghettos, in underprivileged situations, and in prisons for practical purposes, and in the legal system and so forth and so on. There are very many things which need to be reformed and changed, and I think we can do both and should be doing both. All right, any last question? If not, we'll show the film.
Is there any questions on the film?
The film we're going to see, Triumph of Will, I guess it's going to be, is a real important one done by Leni Riefenstahl, who was Hitler's film cinematographer. And it's a very important film. It's a classic propaganda film of the Nazi era, and a very beautiful film, as a matter of fact, which is part of it, one part of its effect on the German people.
is this Friday, March 5th, 8:30 till 5 in the multi-purpose room of the student union. And we do have room for a certain number of community volunteers and students who are willing to help with the conference. And if you're interested, I already have a few people signed up, and if you're interested, speak to me after the class today. Dr. Snyder, is there anything else you want to say about the film? Well, is it ready to go?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
I don't know.
The important thing for those who will see the film is that this is perhaps the first exceedingly effective propaganda film series. Just the best. Which was shown in the movies throughout and was exceedingly effective, namely stimulating enthusiasm for National Socialist ideology, because it was depicted as not only a paradise to become a paradise, but already beginning to be a society which has been changed by this sort of beautiful National Socialist ideology and produced that communal spirit where all people are of the same value and where there is absolute harmony and love for each other, love in quotes, for each other who are like-minded. And so that very many people who don't know very much about National Socialism and its past will leave, if they are really not too well versed in contemporary history, will leave exceedingly enthusiastic and say, my God, how beautiful what they really have been able to accomplish. And that's a society I would like to live. So it was exceedingly clever from a propagandistic point of view and moved people to really unite under the banner of National Socialism. It had a very significant impact on the people of that particular time. And as I said before, it was shown in major movie houses throughout Germany and received several prizes and is, as Carol has said, a classic, because it has been put together so well. Let's see. 1934. And that is the plane in which Hitler just comes to the rally. He was one of the first people who used the plane to go from one place to another. And it was exceedingly effective because he could be in many places in the shortest of possible time. So he's one of the first modern leaders who used the plane extensively. Now the idea of the clouds and all that shows you that the beauty, nature, and the fusion of nature with the people and the German spirit. There's something very wrong with the tone of the film, and maybe it can be adjusted. Because it takes away the impression which you are supposed to get. So you also, what is being called the beauty of ancient Nuremberg, which you can see the architecture, and the new spirit of Germany, so there is a fusion between the old and the new. So-called horse vessel song, which is about a escape. charge of the SS and was the right leader of the SS. these are the tents where all these people came to Nuremberg to celebrate and have this sort of big day assembled. Leaders of tomorrow. So this also reflects the pairing, you know, how they care for each other, the closeness and the cooperation, getting ready for the march, the parades. And all these people you see, they are members of ideology superates. Now, Hitler had a very interesting habit. He knew the psychological effect of looking into someone of one's eye. And then, of course, they said, well, the Führer has looked into my eye and they shook my hand. And that did it, you know, because then whatever happened, they were with him. You can see that. He's the dog. He's quite a bit of that has been described in numerous writings.
Sentences you should listen to very carefully and actually put down right
write it down if you possibly can. You are German. Which is to say that there is a total delegation of individual functions. Hitler is the one who makes decisions regardless of what is moral and what is not. You put a case here of externalization of conscience.
Just a heads up, you saw all those kids' faces, you know, that they all focused on, you know. Around that time, they had a beauty contest for the prettiest little German girl. They asked all the photographers in the country to send in their photo. It was won by a blonde Jewish kid. The fact. The photographer knew it. He wasn't going to give up his prize. And the lady is still alive today, I believe.
Any other questions?